This is Ruby Monsters Go Bump in the Night. I am Jonan. I'm also lead bot on the internet. My Twitter handle is a constant troll to everyone I know. I am the hardest one ever. If you read lead speak, as in you're probably like 30 years of age or older, then you can just look for lead bot, duh. Otherwise, you should like Wikipedia lead speak or something. Okay. I'm from Portland. It's a beautiful city. You should come visit us in beautiful Portland in the spring, preferably, or the summer. Both nice times to visit Portland. They call me Webmaster. I am the webmaster for the Cedar Hills Kindergarten and Preschool Cooperative. It's pretty sweet. You can email me at webmaster@cedarhillspp.org if you have any webmaster needs. Mostly, I think, like, if email's not working as you expected, I think that's my job. So I also, I build things at New Relic sometimes. We work on the Ruby agent at New Relic. And if you have questions about that, you can find me in that building there. We're up near the top. We have the 28th and 29th floor. If you were at RailsConf a couple years ago, you probably came by the office to hang out and we had a party. It was fun. But if you're ever in Portland, seriously, look me up, find me on the internet, and tweet at me, and we'll go to the carts and get some lunch, and you can come hang out in the office and look at our view. It's kind of awesome. I would love to see all of you there. So, also, if you are at all interested in becoming one of us, I am quite pleased to share the Kool-Aid with you. You can go to Bitly Nerd Life to see a list of current openings, or you can just come and talk to me about working at New Relic and why it's so awesome. So, we're actually here today to talk about Ruby Monsters. Pokemon got a woo. Does anyone here play Pokemon or have played Pokemon? Yes, excellent. Much to my 7-year-old daughter Kaya's disappointment, I am not a Pokemon player, but she's giving me lessons. She has Pokemon lessons for myself and my wife, and she reminds me every time we talk about strengths and weaknesses, she's like, yeah, like how some people are bad at Pokemon, like you. You're bad at Pokemon. So Kaya, I'm trying, okay? I've got some Pokemon in my slides here. So I want to talk about, real quick, that I'm not bringing this up as a long list of Ruby WTFs, right? My point is that there are some things in Ruby that are kind of counterintuitive, but not if you understand why they are the way they are. So a lot of times when people come to Ruby as a new language, some things operate a little differently than maybe they expect. And those end up being Ruby monsters, but hopefully, much like the t-shirt that looks like an angry ninja bear in the middle of the night by your closet, and turns out to just be a t-shirt when you wake up, these Ruby monsters are not in fact monsters at all. I've also included some oddities just for your enjoyment, like this little guy. This is my favorite oddity, because I really like Ruby, and there are some odd idiosyncratic bits of Ruby that I find really fun, especially parts that we don't use very often, because Ruby's adorable. Anybody know what this is? This little critter? This is Flight of the Navigator, right? This movie made me want to be an astronaut, because being an astronaut is exactly like that movie. I don't know if anybody knew. This is a Pukmarin. He's fantastic. Okay, so ready, set, talk about Ruby monsters. Our first Ruby monster is the begin-end block, a neutral, hypoallergenic code wrapper made of opinions. So I kind of gave away the end game there a little bit, but I want to talk about what I mean. The begin-end is something you can wrap around things in Ruby and it doesn't change anything, really. So if we have, for example, some splines we need to reticulate, as you do, right? All splines need reticulating. And we wrap that reticulation of splines in a begin-end block. It doesn't change anything. The return value doesn't change. The code still executes exactly the same way. And I can prove it, actually, by showing you the Ruby bytecodes. If you haven't ever done this, this is super fun, and you should. There's this Ruby VM instruction sequence thing, and you can compile the codes as I have here. I just have a simple line of code, puts Ruby is weird, and then you can disassemble them and you can see the actual Ruby instruction sequence, like this. That's what it looks like, which is not as scary as it looks. I'm gonna go through it real quick. That top thing up there, the trace is for set trace func. It shows us where we are in the code later. We can kind of ignore the trace bits now, and it's a stack-based VM, so then that next line, the two there is to put self, the receiver. We put ourselves on there because we're calling puts on self, right? We're calling it at the top level. We put self onto the stack. We put the argument, Ruby is weird, onto the stack. And then we put the method call, right? We call the method. We tell it it's got one argument, the arg count is one, so it pulls the Ruby is weird off, and then it sends it to self, right? And we're done. That's the end of our little bit. So that code is the same as if we wrap it with begin end. We get the same thing, kind of. Discerning eyes will notice there's an extra trace in there for set trace func. But again, we can mostly ignore that. It's to trace the begin end block. In any case, for all intents and purposes, these are the same instructions exactly that are generated when we add begin end, right? So it would make sense that if we are going to reticulate the splines or reticulate them in the begin end block, that is the same thing. So let's do this. If we have do it false, And we've decided not to reticulate this blinds in this case, because do it is false, the if there will keep us from reticulating this blinds, right? Everyone believes me? How about this, do you still believe me? That if do it is false, we put in a begin end block, right? Nothing in that begin end block will happen, right? Because we've got an if here, and do it is false, we're not gonna do it. Correct, we do not reticulate this blinds, right? How about this? Well, false, right? Obviously, we're not going to reticulate this blinds. That makes sense, right? And so then if we put a begin-end block on it, somebody snorted up here, because they know the joke already. Of course it's going to reticulate this blinds. What? What actually happened here is that this is a construct called a do-while loop in Ruby. Begin-end while does not behave as you might expect. This is a while loop that executes once. So like a do-while loop in C, this loop will always execute one time and then it will continue executing. So it maybe is better considered a continue if loop. So it will always reticulate this blinds one time and then it will continue doing it only if do it is true. Mads himself said that this was a thing that he regretted having in Ruby because it's kind of counterintuitive to add a begin end around this while and suddenly the behavior changes so significantly. So if you want a do while loop, he suggests that you use a loop with a break if at the bottom instead of this.
Break.
All right, other things we can do with a begin, we can rescue standard errors, right? I think you're all pretty familiar with this probably. We can else, I don't know if everyone uses that. You can else, so if you don't rescue an error, then you do this thing also, only if there are not errors raised. So we're gonna run one or either of those, and then we have the ensure block we can put at the end, right? And that runs no matter what, the last bit. So again, rescue runs if we have a standard error, else runs if we don't, and ensure runs every time, right? You always ensure in Ruby? Ensure when you absolutely probably maybe need it done approximately right. I may be being a little too hard on ensure in this case, but I'm gonna explain my case. So if we are going to do something important, like eject the core, you know, because we weaponized it and it's overheating and we need to kill the Klingons and not us. So we're gonna send a red alert first to let everyone know we're ejecting the core, and then we wanna probably be pretty sure that that exploding ball of plasma goes out into space instead of staying wherever it is. So we ensure that the core is ejected, right? So in this case here, if the alert happens to be broken, right, the intern was working on the alerting code and now it raises a standard error, and the core eject is still gonna get called, right? We can all agree that the ensure block happens even in the case where we raise a standard error from that alert, right? How about this one? If we raise in the ensure block, it doesn't, right? And that's probably pretty normal behavior, we would expect that. So people, when they're using ensure blocks, they tend not to put things that are dangerous above the really important thing that must happen. So obviously in your code, you're not ejecting cores, you're restoring some piece of state that's super important or unlocking some resource that you've locked, right? But you want to do that before anything risky, anything that might raise an error. Because if you raise an error in the ensure block, you're out of there. You're not going to complete your ensure block, right? So ensure blocks aren't really ensuring in that case, right? Which is fine. You can see that in the code. You would expect that. But what if we're operating in a threaded context? If we are ejecting the core inside of a thread, there's another thing we can do, which is to raise on that thread, right? You can use thread raise to raise an error in the context of the thread in the code. And so anywhere in our eject the core method, we could now raise. We could be raising in the ensure block or before we've even taken the state that we think that we're resetting, right? Lots of things could go wrong when you use thread raise, which is why people say don't use thread raise. Right? You're probably saying, I don't use thread raise, right? I don't do that. You're awesome and you're right. But I was looking through your code the other day and I found this. Actually, you do use thread raise. It looks like here to me that you're raising on the current thread in the rescue block and in the else block. And so you're pretty much guaranteed to raise on the current thread. And you're thinking, how'd you get my code? Well, this is actually timeout in Ruby. So if you're using Ruby timeouts anywhere, or maybe you're using anything that uses Ruby timeouts, I don't know if you've heard of this NetHttp thing, it's pretty popular. Timeouts will just raise on the thread, which is the desired behavior, right? If you tell something to like timeout after 3 seconds, you don't mean like 3 seconds plus however long it takes the ensure block to run. Like you mean done now, right? So it makes sense, but it's important to remember that when you're writing an ensure block, you're not necessarily ensuring that whatever you think is gonna happen is gonna happen. Especially if your code is running in other people's stuff, like maybe you write a gem called New Relic RPM that everyone puts in their crazy Ruby code however they want. Be aware. Okay, so next, an oddity. a lovely little critter. This is the flip-flop. When only the occasional truth will do. Sometimes you maybe want to do a thing. So this is a behavior of ranges in Ruby. If you have an expression in a range, or two expressions, two Boolean expressions in a range, you have two versions of this. You have two dots and three dots. And I always have to look this up every time, but two dots is inclusive and three dots is exclusive, right, I think. So the first range will be evaluated in a loop to process an if block to set up a state. And I'll explain this. I have a diagram here from the pickaxe. This is the state diagram here. So a flip-flop starts as unset. That whole range expression is false. It's unset. Until the first expression evaluates to true for the first time, and then it becomes set. So then we've set the state. And then when the second expression evaluates to true, then we unset the state and we go back. So if we had this in an if block, for example, then we would, when n first became equal to 4, we would set the state. And then n, when n later becomes equal to 7, we would unset the state. So the outcome of this with our flip-flop plot line is that we are going to get that four times here. After the 4, the 5, the 6, and the 7, and then n is equal to 7, and we stop. We flip back to the unset state. So flip-flop operators are actually pretty straightforward when you think of them that way. The difference between the 2-dot and the 3-dot version is that the 2-dot version evaluates both of the Boolean expressions for each loop. So if I'm looping through and n becomes equal to 4, right, like this, the 2-dot version is going to check that the first expression is true and it's going to set the state. And then it's going to check that the second expression is true and it's going to unset the state. And like the do-while loop, it always runs the code in between one time. So we're going to get puts flip-flop pow one time, like this. But it's going to end in the unset state, and we're going to be done then, right? Because we had n equals 4 and n equals 4 on the two sides of the range. So if we use the 3-dot version of that, this is maybe the part that's a little bit unexpected. We're going to go through and we're only going to evaluate one expression per state. So if we're in the unset state, we evaluate the first expression to transition to the set state. And we don't evaluate the second expression right then. We evaluate it on the next iteration to the loop when n is 5. So n is no longer 4, right? And it never becomes 4. So we just continue outputting every time in that flip-flop. Probably you don't use flip-flops because they're super weird, but they're fun, right? You need more flip-flops in your code. You should do that. So to recap, expression 1, expression 2, in the inclusive version, evaluates both expressions on each pass through the loop. And the 3-dot version evaluates just the first expression. So. That's enough about flip-flops, let's talk about scope. Like voting districts for your code with more gerrymandering. So scope in Ruby is not actually that difficult to understand, but it can be when you come from another language for a lot of reasons. But let's just start here. Hope, right? If you just open up IRB and you type hope, we all know hope doesn't exist, right? You get undefined local variable. There is no hope. There's never been any hope. But here is something interesting about Ruby. What about this? If I have hope inside of this if false block, surely this will not run and I don't have a hope, right? So when I check if hope is defined, then I wouldn't get local variable because hope is now defined. If I never ran that code and I said, hey Ruby, this code that's coming, don't run this code. Ruby does anyway. So if you're creating local variables, even inside of blocks that are not executed, those local variables are created by Ruby and then sent to nil. It's a very strange thing once you see it for the first time and it can bite you in unexpected ways. So just something to keep out for. There is no hope, but sometimes hope is new. Let's launch the missiles. So I was working on this DoD project the other day where I was launching the missiles, and we had this secret launch code, right? And I chose N because it's an embedded system. We need short variable names. Rights are very important to us. So N, for my short variable name, is the secret launch code leafbolt. And we're going to launch with the secret launch code leafbolt. And then the PM came to me and he said, Jonan, we need a countdown. People love countdowns with missiles, so hook us up. And I was like, okay, I can totally do countdowns, right? We got this 10 times do n, right? And then we're gonna put launching in 10 minus n and sleep one. And maybe somebody was like, whoa, n, you can't use n, you just use n. Actually, it's fine, right? Ruby shadows these variables. Inside of the loop here, inside of the times block from do to n, we made a block. That n is a different n than the outside n, right? Not surprising to anyone. So inside of this 10 times loop, we've got n counting up, and then we go back out and we send the secret launch code, and everything is glorious, except that I'm... So the first time 10 times executes, it runs with n equal to 0, And that really annoys me because everyone knows that counting starts at one. It's a thing that comes up for me a lot in programming. So I decided to use this other construct that I know about called the for loop. Because this one starts at one, and it's so much better, right? Because then I know when I come back to this code, it's going to be easier for me to figure out what's going on. I'm not going to have that, like, how do you count to zero moment, right? So I use this for n in 1 to 10, but it's launching in 11 minus n. This is way better, okay? And then I end. And then I send the secret launch code, and the secret launch code is always 10. Did that surprise anybody? Did you know for loops have no scope at all in Ruby? Like, for loops will just manipulate all the things around them. They look like they have a block. They don't at all. So this is probably one of the reasons why for loops are not super popular in Ruby. But there are a lot of reasons why for loops are not super popular. We have so many other better options. So the point that I was trying to get out there is that you have a whole new world every time that you iterate through. This block that we're yielding to, when I showed you that the iterator earlier in times, the C code, we are yielding to the block with a bit of an argument here, so the word here, right? So every time we iterate through a whole new world, A and whole and new and world are new args passed to this thing and they get a new go every time they go through, right? So closures, they're exactly like that one thing from that one language, except sometimes when they're not. Closures in Ruby are mostly surprising to people who are not Rubyists, because if you were born and bred on Ruby, it makes a lot of sense. But if you expect them to behave like closures in other languages, sometimes you will be surprised at the behavior. So Wikipedia describes these as in programming languages, a closure, also lexical closure or function closure, is a function or reference to a function together with a reference to the environment. A table storing a reference to each of the non-local variables, also called free variables or up values of that function. A closure, unlike a plain function pointer, enables a function to access those non-local variables even when invoked outside its immediate lexical scope. So I think we're clear on that, and I'm just going to move on to the next topic. I think I have a better way to say that, and that's that they're portable code pods, right? That's what closures are. We just like scoop up this bit of code, and the code travels around. We can pass it around like an object, and it remembers where it came from. So the scope of that code, it picks up the pieces that it needs when it goes somewhere. So non-local variables from nearby are remembered, and things that are called in context are taken with, right? So it's a portable code pod. Maybe that'll make it easier to think about as we talk about closures here a little bit. But there are three different forms of closures, basically. And a couple of these are the same. You'll find out in a moment. There's a block, right? A proc, and a lambda in Ruby. So blocks, we'll start with that. We've seen these already. This is the do-end thing that you're doing of those curly braces, right? When we say 10 times do puts Ruby monsta, or we do it again with the curly braces. That was a little Japanese accent intro for you guys there. That's what you could see at Ruby Kaiki next year if you come hear me talking Japanese. Ruby monsta. Okay, so this is how we use blocks in Ruby, right? I'm sure this is not new to anybody. This is the thing that I was talking about where we're yielding inside of this C here. This is what times does internally. We've got this block, and we're yielding with the counter. So we've got the counter as we're iterating, n is 10 in this case, and times internally is taking the number each time, starting with 0, and handing it off to the block that we gave it. So we're yielding, every time we go through 10 times do, we're yielding to the block and we're passing an argument, right? But that argument we're not accepting in this code that we wrote. When we wrote 10 times do n Ruby monster, we explicitly said we don't take any arguments. This block does not require arguments. And we're giving it an argument, and yet it works. It doesn't raise an argument error. So blocks don't really care about arguments. Here is another example of that, where we're using the count, right? We're doing 10 times. One, zero, I'm sorry, zero, the count would never have said that. Nobody counts from zero, come on. Okay, so you count every time you go through, it takes the variable, and again, if we give it too many, right, that's fine. If we're like, hey, we actually needed four arguments, I don't know if you can do that, because it can't, times is just gonna give you the one, but you're not gonna raise an error. You're going to raise an argument error because blocks need this functionality. You need to be able to have the flexibility when you're writing the code to just say do n. If you don't care about the count, you don't care about the count, just leave it out, right? And that's fine. So another way that blocks are used in Ruby is as implicit blocks. You pass a block to every method, or you can pass a block to any method. Like this, I have this boom method. It doesn't do anything with a block, but I can pass a block to it that puts ah, and it just does its business and moves on with its life. It got an argument it didn't care about or want to deal with, right? So we can use yield to call that block. This is probably not a surprise to anyone. We say boo and ah, and then we yield to the block that was called in there. That's the implicit block. Every method in Ruby takes a block, you pass the block in, and then you can call it by yielding to the block. That code will execute. Another way you can do the same thing is you can actually name that variable. I've named it block in this case for clarity, but I could call it blueberry if I wanted. And then I could blueberry.call, And it would do the same thing. Interestingly, when you take that ampersand off of the block, it becomes a proc. So if you were to ask on this block.call line, block.class, it would tell you it's a proc. But blocks are not procs. They just have very similar behavior. And a proc is just basically a reified version of a block. So you can think of them as the same thing for all intents and purposes. It's just that one is not an object yet. So boo takes in this block, and then boo-ah happens because we're block.calling, right? So let's talk about procs and the differences there. So proc is one of the ways you can create that. You can use the proc keyword. This only works from 1.9 forward. Confusingly, from 1.9 or from 1.8 and back, proc actually created lambdas. One of the reasons why closures in Ruby get a bad rap. So proc now creates procs in 1.9, and you can also do proc.new to create a proc. So you can do a proc return call, and the return in this context is going to scoop up the context around it. So when you create a proc and you type return, it's the same as if you had just typed return. If I go into IRB and I type this, that return is going to be as if I had just typed return in IRB. I'm going to get a local jump error, unexpected return, right? So when I get this local jump error, it's saying, I don't have anywhere to go. You're at the top level. There's nothing to return from. I'm not in the method, you derp, right? So that's the same problem that I would have with that proc. If I had that return, it's bound to that context where it was created. It scoops up that bit and takes it with it. So later, when I call the proc from anywhere, it's going to try and return from that top level context, and I'm going to get a local jump error. So I'm going to illustrate that a little differently here. These are two different implementations of the same thing. In my Kansas method here, I'm returning. I get a return immediately from Kansas. And when I proc new and then I return from that proc, I'm returning from Kansas. That is Kansas's return. I'm not returning from the proc, I'm returning from the method. Right? So if I do something like this, where I go into Kansas and I create a proc and it's got a return in it, Kansas's return, and I pass that proc containing Kansas's return over to Oz, right? And then I call it from Oz, I'm going to immediately return from Oz. If there were more lines in Oz, I would not process those lines of code. And I'm going to go back to Kansas and I want to immediately return from Kansas. Because that's what that return does. It was created in that context for that proc, right? So I return out of Oz and out of Kansas immediately. Different way to look at this, if I were to do it this way, where I call Oz and Oz creates the proc internally, the return in this case is bound to Oz, right? I'm returning from Oz. So when I call the second line in Oz, that return, I don't process the rest of Oz. I can get rid of that code. I just go right back to Kansas. But Kansas, of course, continues executing. So it's going to put the local home, okay? So return in the context of a proc bounds to the local context, the outer Ruby, right? So lambdas work differently. Two ways to create a lambda in Ruby. You can use the lambda keyword, or you can use the new stabby lambda, which is really kind of an aggressive and violent name for that. I think we should go with baby rocket, like baby hash rocket. So you can use the baby rocket lambda, or you can type lambda, the keyword. And if you, in Kansas, create a lambda, this return is going to return from inside the lambda. If you call this lambda, it's going to return that. It's not going to return out of Kansas. If there were more lines in Kansas, they would continue to execute normally. It's more like you're doing this. You're creating an anonymous function, and you're returning from that anonymous function, and it returns immediately. It doesn't do anything else, but it's not going to return from Kansas, right? So if you have one version of Kansas that has a lambda, the puts will run. If you have a version that has a proc, the puts will not run. We'll return out of the entire out of context. So the other difference between Ruby procs and lambdas is the argument lists. On the top, we've got a baby rocket lambda created with A and B, two arguments. You must give it two arguments. If a lambda is told that it gets zero arguments or one arguments or two arguments, you give it what you told it you would give it, or you will get an argument error. And procs don't care, right? Necessarily, because we were looking at blocks earlier. And it would be kind of annoying if you had to know exactly how many arguments times was going to pass to every block that you ever created. So blocks are flexible, as are procs with arity. You don't have to pass them the correct number of arguments. Too few or too many is fine. So just like we did here with the 10 times do, where we had an argument and we ignored it, it's okay. Or we can ask for too many, and that's also okay. Right? So the reason that we're doing that is as we're iterating through this whole new world. Let's say, like, inside of here, we were just putting hello. I would be able to use a whole new world to put hello four times, and that should be fine, right? I don't have to actually use that word variable inside of there. It doesn't make sense that I should be required to use that argument. So that's why blocks function that way they do with regard to arguments. The return bit, why they return from that scope, is that I would expect this return here to return from whole new world. And I think you probably expect the same thing. But imagine if this functioned like a lambda. If that do end was returning from an iteration, then the each method would go through the first time and it would take A and it would hand that string A into this block that we've created, this lambda, as word, and it would return. And then it would go get world, and then it would hand it to lambda. So it would operate like next does. in that context. So return would just be skipping to the next iteration, which is obviously not the desired behavior, right? And that's why blocks and procs return the way that they do, and why lambdas don't. So to go back over all of that, blocks and procs have arbitrary arguments. You can make it up as you go, but they return home. The context of that return is the context that you'll return to. And lambdas have strict arguments, and they return locally. If a return happens inside of a lambda, it just returns from itself back to whatever called it. So that hopefully helps you understand this bit of code here, which is a whole chunk of code I don't want you to read all right now because I'm going to break it down. So this first one, we're going to define a method dynamically called WorksFine. Takes a block, calls the block. It works fine because it works fine. I've called it that. So this is not going to be a problem. We define this method works fine. It also runs. We have another one called also works fine. Guess what? This works fine. That one's fine too. We can define the method with def, and that will function just as the other one, right? We've got this block argument and we call it. Okay, good. This one blows up. If we dynamically define a method called explodes and we yield, it's going to blow up. But this one's not going to blow up. It seems like it should. This is the same thing that we just did, right? They're both yielding. Except that in the case of explodes, that yield binds to the class dynamical. And if you defined a class dynamical and just typed yield in it and tried to run that code, you'd get a local jump error because you yield, or you get a no block given. You get an error for no block given because you don't have a block there. So the yield is in the context of that entire class, and then you were defining a method explodes and it takes that context with it. If you were to use a lambda to define that method, it would be different. But in this case, we're not. This is having the yield proc block behavior of binding to this context. So I also want to cover real quick ways to call a proc. I've been using call throughout all of this. Procs and blocks, or procs and lambdas can call it the same way. There are four ways to do it in Ruby. You can call, you can use square brackets, you can use dot parentheses, and you can also use dot square brackets. I've never seen that one. I discovered that accidentally the other day, and I can't figure out how or if it can take arguments. I've had some people try to explain it to me, but if you have a way to try and explain to me why this exists, it will call a proc. It just won't take an argument list. You'll get a syntax error. So teach me how to use that if you know. I have one final bit of Ruby awesome for you. I want to tell you about GoTo in Ruby. Maybe you didn't know that this was actually a thing in Ruby. You can use GoTo. So the never-ending story here, if we had a start label and then a GoTo start, then our tax would never have died in the stupid swamps of sadness, and my childhood would not have been ruined. So we just loop forever on the never-ending story, and we keep pushing it, and GoTo is definitely a thing that we need, right? So I'm going to tell you how to turn this on in Ruby, because it's super useful. You can go into your VM options header file in your Ruby source code and find the support joke definition here, and you change that 0 to a 1 and recompile Ruby, and you get GoTo. Sweet. Please don't use that. There are a couple other jokes that are super fun. One is the answer to the universe and everything, which I will leave to you an exercise for the reader to figure out what that answer is. So then you too in your code can use things like GoToStart. Welcome to Ruby Monsters, Go Bump in the Night. My name is Jonan, also Lead Bob on the internet. I'm from Portland. It's a beautiful city you should visit in the spring.